You don't need to be an expert in order to achieve satisfactory investment returns. All you need to do is to recognize your limitations and follow a course certain to work well. These are the valuable words lifted from the world's most admired investor, Warren Buffett's recent letter to his shareholders, where he talks about his two real estate investments. Today in the Realty Debate, my attempt will be to cull out that simple course of action, which can ensure that you don't go wrong with your property investments and make reasonable returns. My panel today, Ritesh Vora, Partner Real Estate, IDFC Alternatives. Also, Harsh Rungta, CEO, ApnaPaisa.com. Amrish Baliga, Managing Partner, Global Wealth Management, Edelweiss Financial Services. Vineet Singh, Business Head, 99acres.com. Ramesh Menon, Director, Certis Realty. And Sameer D'Souza, Founder and CEO of PropEquity. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining me. Let me begin with that first notion that I think a majority of people in this country with 1.2 billion population have, that property prices can't go down, especially if you're willing to hold the asset for 3 years plus. My big question is it a myth or reality? I can see Harsh smiling there. So Harsh, over to you with that first question.
I would say that's a myth, because we have seen property prices go down. I mean, even in India, I mean, anybody who's been at it for some time knows. I mean, we've had this period during the mid-90s. We've had this period during the mid-first decade, 2004, 2003, 2004 period. In fact, there has been, at least as far as Bombay is concerned, and we've done these numbers on the ready reckoner rates that are published in Bombay for the last 20 years, and we have a 10-year period over which there is a negative return, slightly negative, but there is. So I think this notion that property prices have only one way to go and that's up, I think is something that people need to think about. Because we have seen it drop in the past, and it's hugely regulation driven. I mean, the supply of any commodity that's completely rationed and where the rationing rules can change overnight. I would take anything on that with the normal caution that I would have on any asset class. So I think that is the only point. I'm not saying it's a bad asset class. I'm just saying the normal caution that I would associate with any asset class, I would associate it with real estate as well.
Okay. So you're saying it's a myth, because there has been a prolonged period, almost a decade, where India's real estate actually saw a deep depression and came out of it just maybe slightly negative. Amrish Palika, maybe that period has been forgotten. You know, if you look at 2004-5 onwards, literally till the last maybe 9 months, previous 9 months, you saw a kind of a secular run with perhaps just a short period when prices just, you know, real estate transactions got locked out, and that was post the subprime crisis in the US. So is it that we've forgotten? Is that the reality?
That's what normally happens in any sort of a bull run, whether it's a stock market or the real estate market or even in gold. When you have the prices moving up for a long period of time, people tend to forget that the prices can come down. So I would clearly say it's a myth. At least if you're talking of a period between 1 to 10 years, I suppose it's a myth, because we have seen that in the past. In Bombay itself, in 95, Nariman Point was about 25,000. And by about 2002, 2003, you could get properties at about 8,500, 9,000. So that's sort of a crack we have seen. Recently, we have seen that in Hyderabad, where people had bought at much higher levels in 2008, and those prices are still not seen. So if you're talking of a period up to 10 years, yes, I suppose you should see a correction. But in India, again, if you're talking of a much longer period, if you're talking of 15, 20 years plus, prices have gone up, and that will continue moving up as long as the population keeps rising and the demand is there.
Okay. Sameer, you know, 50% of India's household savings, and that's what your RBI data says, goes into real estate. So one is that buying property for a middle class Indian in tier one cities or even tier two cities is no longer a cheap thing. It's an expensive proposition. So I think the bulk is because of that. But do you believe that especially in the last 9 to 12 months, when we've started seeing a correction, that correction is over? or is this the beginning?
It's very difficult to answer that question now, because now the real estate markets are more becoming like the stock markets, where you have to
which is a very scary thing where
you need to understand a lot more data points, parameters, dynamics before you make the right decision. You know, today demand supply plays the biggest role, which was not the case about 5 years ago. There was hardly any supply. It was literally a seller's market. Now, with so much supply coming in, and the supply, and it also depends on what price points we're talking about. So at luxury price points, it is there's an oversupply, or a mid market in certain cities there is an oversupply. But if you, for example, look at Bombay, ready built up, the prices are phenomenal, but there's no new supply coming up. So you cannot expect prices to come down, because the demand far outstrips supply in those kind of cities, right? And you have to work and live in those cities. So from an end use perspective, you will continue to buy even if the prices are
okay,
high.
So hold your thought. That's what I think the interesting part is, that it's no longer a blind investment beneath, isn't it? There was a time when you just looked at a reasonable property, or someone even just called you up and said, hey, that's a great property to buy. I'm buying. Why don't you just buy it? And you would probably, you know, not go wrong with that.
Yeah.
Right? 2005, 2006, everybody's sitting on very hefty profits if they did invest in real estate. Now, the market has become much, much smarter and data driven.
Yeah, you are absolutely right. The myth is broken that real estate is a solid investment where the only thing that you get is
there's no downside.
Returns.
That's what
there's
I've
no
heard
downside.
From people. So, maybe it won't do well, but there's no downside. It's not going to go down.
Yeah. So real estate is a very good investment product, a good investment asset class, but it is the riskiest because the quantum of money involved is the highest.
Yes.
Two, just before coming here, I was going through the top 15 cities data in terms of top three performing localities in terms of price increase, and the bottom three performing localities in terms of price decrease. And each and every city, okay, you see top three localities in a range of 5 to 20% price increase, and the bottom three all negative.
Really?
Okay, so in the same market, you have localities which are giving you 10-20% capital value return on an annual basis, and there are localities which are giving you -20%, -10%, -5% as well. So real estate investment education for the general consumer has become a very, very important thing. It is very important that a retail investor educates himself or herself on how to go about investing in real estate, do due diligence and research before choosing where they want to invest. Because like the stock markets, it is very important that which stock do you invest in? Are you catching a rally? Are you catching the right stock? Are you catching some sort of growth story in that particular industry or company, and so on? The same is a story that is repeating itself in real estate.
So it's just become very, very data driven and factor driven. It's not like real estate will do well anywhere. Has the euphoria settled down, Ramesh? I mean, you're in touch with investors very regularly. And do you think that there's a little bit of sanity which has come back into the market, where investors are not that eager to pump in money into real estate?
I won't say there was a euphoria earlier too, but the fact remains that
yes, there was an euphoria. Believe me, every from the time I started doing the property show, I would walk into a get together on a Saturday evening, and people would ask me, where should I put my money in real estate?
That was because there was the people with, especially the salaried class, where they had the ability to leverage capital from the banking system, etc. Probably two places where they went wrong was they could not input the cost of capital and the inflation into their purchases.
Right.
That is where all this negative thing is coming. But to mention the HNI, the ultra HNI audience, which primarily invests into slightly larger ticket of real estate, they are circumspect, primarily owing to the fact that there is a lot of political uncertainty, and the no government in the past few years has actually accelerated the process of permissions and regulation.
It's a hugely regulated industry.
Yeah. So hence there is this inkling doubt whether their money would see the fruition of the returns that they seek.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, there is circumspection around that investment now.
There is. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Ritesh, come in here. You've just closed a real estate fund. I mean, we'll come to the fact, come to the various methods you have to invest in real estate. But you would have studied and researched a lot before creating a real estate fund, which will invest primarily in residential assets of this country. Tell me, what's your prognosis for the next 3 to 5 years?
Sure. So, when we looked at the markets, our sense clearly was that over the next 2 to 3 years or let's say 4 year period, we were not very, very positive or bullish taking an equity exposure in real estate projects in India, which is why when we crafted this particular fund, we looked at a debt type strategy where we've actually raised a fund which is specifically a residential lending fund. And what we're really trying to do in this fund is to actually go into projects which have already been launched, which have been substantially de-risked in terms of approvals and construction mobilization and sales, and actually lend to those real estate developers to essentially generate a certain fixed kind of a IRR for our investors over the next 3 to 4 year time horizon. Our sense clearly is that there is an oversupply in many markets. There is all sorts of data points that today can impact real estate prices and real estate sentiments, and especially given the current environment where we are just heading into an elections, where the there is some amount of uncertainty in terms of what the future would hold over the next couple of years, we felt this was a better strategy to go with.
All right, hold your thought. You did actually, isn't your fund aiming a 22% IRR?
Yeah, we're looking at IRRs in the early 20s. That's right.
Okay, early 20s. Now, that's what's exciting. If you look at returns, if you were to invest directly into a real estate product, which is a residential home or a plot, what are the returns that you're likely to get? I mean, after all, should you be not looking at the kind of appreciation you would be getting, or should you go if you can afford to a slightly higher ticket of investment, also enter through funds which are investing in India's real estate market? We'll come back and look at that question. It's a really interesting discussion. How do you make the most of your real estate investments? And it's not all about going after that pre-launch project which brokers chase you with. How do you make the most of your real estate investment? This question begs an answer, especially because over the last 9 to 12 months, we've seen real estate transactions come down, prices also being mellow, and people, actually investors, becoming illiquid. They're not able to sell their property. In fact, we've received a couple of distress mails from people who are sitting on property, two or three of them, and are trying to look for buyers. Unfortunately, there are no buyers in the horizon. That doesn't mean that you stop investing in real estate or don't have that in your portfolio. It's just a question of how do you make smart moves. So some of the questions I have for my panelists, and one by one we'll come to all those questions. What do you buy? Do you buy an apartment, or do you buy a plotted development? That's just a plot. Or you actually look for land in some places where it could give you fantastic returns. What's better, a tier one city? Do you stick to those, or do you actually go down to tier two cities looking for even higher returns at a higher risk? Then of course there's commercial versus residential story. Which one will pan out for you better? And finally, the most important one, a real estate fund, is that worth your money? So let me start with the land versus an apartment question. And Ramesh, because you're in the game of the land, what do you think?
See, if your capital is patient and if it is not leveraged and you have a substantial amount, see, I do not advise.
There are three things.
Yes.
You need to have substantial capital.
Yes.
You can't take leverage on land.
Yes.
And it has to be patient capital. When you say patient, how long?
See, if you have to have your benchmarked IRRs on land, you must at least wait for 3 to 5 years. See, the highest returns that you make on land is when you create a product out of the land. Land in its form is just can at best be utilized for farming, right? So when the approvals come in, if you can convert the land into a product or a licensable or a saleable product, you actually end up utilizing the highest FAR that is permissible on it. So that is when you make the highest yield on it. Having said that, there are people in the market, some including like us, who are land watchers on a day-to-day basis, and we have the ability to buy and flip on a regular basis. But I do not advise it to your audience to get into land if you do not have all the three parameters in place, right? And definitely not for the salaried, especially the beginners, to leverage loans and get into land. That is a strict no-no for that audience.
Okay, so strict no-no. He's already ruled out, I think, 50-60% of the people. I think those are very good three thumb rules to go with. Patient capital, your own capital, no leverage, and of course not in the early stages of your career or your life or your business, but much later when you're very comfortable and your risk appetite is higher.
Yeah.
So then I think the second question is, we, which again Sameer and I constantly tackle on the show is, in an area, let's say, as Gurgaon or Noida, do I go for plotted development, plots in developed communities, or do I go for flats? Why is there this sense that plots will do much better? Because most investors prefer to buy a plot and end users are looking more at flats.
No, historical returns on land or plot, residential plots, has been much better. Hmm. Okay, but having said so, I think the market is changing. One is, as Ramesh rightly said, the capital requirement is much higher. And if you look at current data, without naming certain projects, you said Gurgaon. So in Gurgaon, three years ago, if a plot was launched at 40,000 rupees a square yard, even today, the price is the same.
It's the same?
Another plotted development launched at 60,000 rupees a square yard around 2.5 years ago. Today, the price is the same. So there's no return. Almost 80-90%, the buyer has almost paid 80-90% of the total payment. Okay.
Correct.
The plots will be delivered in the next 6 to 12 months without any price appreciation at all.
So capital is actually depreciated, so, isn't it?
So residential apartments, though they may give you slightly lesser return, okay, there is a safety net. Okay. Your probability of going below your purchase price is very less. If the market burns down, everything burns down. Everything goes below. Okay, but here still you will make. Like, you take a look at Dwarka Expressway, where the current rate is 7 to 10,000 bucks a square feet. Resale rates are, let's say, 4,500 to 6,000 rupees a square feet. But still, nobody is wanting to sell below their purchase price. Hmm. Okay, whereas in land it is totally different. If you bought a piece of land, 300 square yards of 40,000 rupees 3 years ago, and you're willing to sell me at the same rate today, that means you are booking a loss.
You are booking a loss.
Okay. So there, I think it plays a different role. So residential apartment, okay. In today's market, what I would suggest to retail buyers is, if you want to invest in residential real estate, buy residential real estate where from day one you can take a mortgage. So take leverage from day one and then invest.
So mortgage, and therefore it still makes more sense to invest in a flat or an apartment, Sameer? I mean, I'm curious to know that really plots have just not done well.
No, again, we come back to the demand supply.
Lucknow plots have done well. So there are some markets they've done well in, but
this question has to be taken in two parts. One, again, demand supply. Hmm. Now, Noida, Gurgaon, all these cities are opening up many, many plotted development areas.
In fact, now developers are running short of cash, so they prefer to do plotted developments because they're easier to launch.
There is a market for both, right? For an apartment, you get bank leverage, so the returns can be as good as plotted development. Typically, people who go in for plotted development are two types of people. One, people want to park their cash, so that they don't really care about the leverage, and they don't really care about, and there's an underlying asset.
Cash component.
The most important part is that there is an underlying asset below. The second part is that the apartment culture is only in a very few cities. And we have still a very large portion of the population which believes that I want my own roof and I want my own ground, and that is not going to change. A person becomes an apartment buyer in, say, a Mumbai or say in Gurgaon, because he's got used to and got exposed to people living in apartments and really, really appreciating that form of living, because there's a lot of infrastructure that's available that
right
you don't really have to take care
of. Right now, we're only talking about investors, really, so not an end-user question.
So if you look at tier 2 cities, plotted development does far more better, because people who are going to buy from an investor also is going to be an end user who wants to live in his own house.
Okay, fair
enough. If you look at Delhi, for example, there is no supply of land right now, so plots keep on going higher and higher. Right? In Gurgaon, because plots and apartments are in abundance, and plots take 20 years to get developed because people buy them as an investment, and then, so in Gurgaon, for example, apartments are doing much better with bank leverage.
Okay, all right. Gurgaon is also the city of a huge number of white-collared employees, and that's probably the reason why it's easy for them to get bank leverage also. Harshumta, what do you think? I mean, take leverage and then invest in real estate. What are the downsides? Because we've only heard some of the positives so far.
I think, Manisha, just I would like to take just a minute here and define what we mean by real estate. You know, when we talk flats, in most cases, because of the sheer amount of marketing available, we're talking under construction flats. When a lay person buys an under construction flat, let us be clear, he is not buying real estate. He is doing in a small way what Ritesh is doing as a fund. He is lending money to the builder. Okay, that is the asset class that he is in. He is not into flats. It is only when the property will get ready that it turns into real estate. Okay, as far as leveraging is concerned, I mean, leveraging is very simple. If your appreciation is higher than the leveraging rate, leveraging makes sense. If your leveraging rate is higher, then obviously you're actually going to make a further loss. The big issue with taking leveraging on under construction flat is that it is not tax deductible. Very few people actually know this. Okay, it is not tax deductible, and I mean 10.5%, which is the current leveraging rate, non-tax deductible is 10.5%, and I don't know too many even residential properties that is going to give a 10.5% return year after year compounded. So leveraging will actually increase your losses as long as the increase is not as high as 10.5%. So I think key is, when we people talk real estate, people should be very clear that if they are talking real estate, either plots, because at least that is sellable as plots, or if they are talking flats, okay, then they should be talking of real ready flats. Otherwise, they are in the lending business, and that is the return that they should be looking at. I mean, Ritesh looks at 22%. As an individual, what should I look at? I think that is something that each individual should ponder over, given the fact that Ritesh would do a huge amount of due diligence, a lot of documentation and security, whereas as an individual, for me to even be able to get back anything from the builder, I mean, let get an audience with him, forget about getting my money back, is going to be a big deal. So, I mean, the risk associated with that investment is so high, I just can't even begin to see how it makes sense.
All right. Okay, Harsh, Roongta has clearly laid out all the negatives which could come. Well, what are you looking at? I mean, if it's an under construction flat, you're actually lending to a developer. Why is it then, Amrish, that globally, if you look at it, high net worth investors' portfolios are so concentrated in real estate? I mean, they have to be a smarter lot, is what I'm believing.
Worldwide, in fact, people have been investing in real estate, and that is what has caught on in India in a couple of years. Basically, because they are the ones who can actually put in enough money up front, and at the same time, they are able to leverage. And the sort of returns they have made in the past 7 to 8 years has in fact made them invest more and more, because of which most of the HNIs, if you look at, clearly about 40 to 50%, if not more, of their portfolio is actually into real estate, which seems clearly on the higher side. Because generally recommend that people should not be investing more than 15 to maximum 30% of their portfolio in real estate.
Okay. 30%. Is that the number, Ritesh? Wear the hat of a retail investor. Do you buy into Harsh Roongta's point that if you're looking at flipping property, getting into early stage construction, actually what you're doing is only funding a developer with much higher risks than probably a fund like yours would have to take?
I think that's certainly partially true, because really what you're doing is buying into an under construction project, which is probably going to take maybe, you know, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years to get completed, and that's the time when you're actually going to get the key to that apartment that you've actually bought into. Till that time, you are taking the risk of the markets slowing down, you are taking the risk of the developer going bankrupt, you are taking the risk of some permission issues coming through, etc., etc. But the flip side to that is that if the only option is to actually buy ready and completed properties, then effectively you're actually going to be buying into this asset class at a much higher price, because of the fact that typically completed properties command a premium over under construction projects. Obviously, you need to put 100% down right at one moment, whereas with an under construction project, you get the benefit of the fact that you have to pay over 2 or 3 years or 4 years. And frankly, if you are an investor and not really looking at end use of that particular apartment, I know a lot of investors were actually happy if the project gets delayed by a year or two, because they actually pace out their investments in a more gradual fashion. So I think it totally depends on what you're looking at, what your objective is. But but yes, that's an analogy that has some relevance.
All right. So then the other question, Ritesh, and back to you, in terms of owning real estate in any form in your portfolio, would you use the thumb rule of about 30%? Is that the maximum that one should go with?
You know, it's a very difficult question. I don't really have an answer to it, but I think the moot point here is that if you are in, let's say, any of the top 5-6 cities, or even the top 10-15 cities, possibly the smallest real estate investment that you could make with a reasonable developer, with a reasonable project, would at least be in the 20-40 lakh range. So if you're looking at saying that this should be 15-20% or 30% of your portfolio, then your portfolio should be at least probably a crore of rupees, which I'm not sure how many people have in terms of the total investable surplus. Also, obviously, the fact that your primary residence has to be not calculated in your investable surplus. So you're talking about owning your primary residence and then having a crore more to invest. Which is why, unfortunately, what happens is that most of the investors in India who are onto a second property typically end up having a structure where maybe 60-70% of their investable surplus is locked into a property and only 20-30% maybe going into financial products.
Right. I know. It's a lumpy product. I mean, I think we've established it and yet the monies are flowing into real estate. So we'll come back and take a look at a few more questions that we still have left, which is... If you are an ardent and a diehard fan of real estate, then how do you narrow down on the right investment? We've looked at a couple of questions, but there's more to go. Keep watching. How do you make the most of your real estate investments? Welcome back. I think through all that the panelists have said, it's very clear that you become an investor in real estate only after you've got a reasonable portfolio size, at least a crore plus, and you also have a home of your own that you live in, which you don't count as investment. We've also looked at plot versus land versus an actual end product, which is a flat. But there are a couple of more questions, so let's get on with them. Vineet, the next question, why not commercial real estate? Because if you're looking at, rental yields 9-12% versus 2.5-3%, as low as that in residential.
If I look at the market, 80% of the market is new launch and under construction kind of properties. So there again, it's a question of ticket size, affordability, what can you afford. So if I invest into a new launch kind of a commercial product today, one should have a 7-10 year kind of a purview in terms of rate of return. Otherwise, in this kind of a market, yes, if you can afford to buy a pre-leased kind of a property with maybe 7-11% kind of annual return, yes, it's a fantastic product. But you have to understand and be aware and intelligent real estate investor to get into retail or commercial assets.
So commercial is not everybody's game, Sameer, isn't it? It has to be, you have to have a lot of intelligence and you probably have to have that, again, some amount of patience in case it can't be leased, you still have sunken cost, all of that, lots of things have to be factored in.
Yeah, you see, the thing is that you're absolutely right that in the past, for example, commercial was a good asset class to own because it used to give you a good rental yield and people wanted that kind of rental yield. And I actually, what I want to say is why people buy residential even with a 2.5% rental yield is because it's not, nobody would buy residential for 2.5%. It's because of capital appreciation.
But now, Sameer, when we know
covers up for the rental yield loss.
But now going forward is what my big question is. Your rental yields are still 2-3%. Your capital appreciation looks like there's more and more uncertainty around that capital appreciation.
We have to now go back to the drawing board and we have to look at micro market specific data. And decisions have to be taken based on that. For example, now if you look at commercial right now, in the right micro market, it's probably giving you a 9% yield. It's become lower than the residential pricing. It may just give you much better returns than a residential product.
Yeah.
And it's not that scientific. Yes, you have to probably hold on to it a little bit more in terms of you have to pay CAM charges and all that if your property is vacant. But if you're smart enough, you make the right property decision in commercial today. Why is the Blackstone going out and investing few billion dollars? They are the best, biggest private equity investors. They are open, they can invest in residential as well.
But they're looking
because
at commercial.
They are seeing commercial bottoming out. They are going after ready, good, great assets, which are not only providing them a 9 to 10% yield, but will give them further capital appreciation also.
Because commercial prices have actually, or at least some say, close to bottoming out. I won't say bottomed out because no one really knows that. Amrish Balika, Kotak Realty, Fire Capital, Redford, Blackstone, just look at the kind of assets that they're lapping up. And of course, a lot of them, Citigroup, Goldman Sachs, most of that is commercial real estate asset. Is it that, you know, we last year we basically told all our investors, retail investors, stay away from commercial. That's not the market that you understand. It's risk fraught. Yet, do you think we need to rethink that advice altogether now at this juncture?
No, again, I mean, if you're talking of the next couple of years, I don't see the commercial real estate market really bouncing back because inventory levels are high, the supply is huge. But then with the foreign investment hopefully flowing into REITs, I think that should happen sooner than later. I suppose that is the time you'll slowly see, I mean, action coming back into the commercial real estate, which in fact, I mean, the way I see it is possibly, I mean, this space should bounce back in the next 4 to 5 years plus. So from that point of view, if, I mean, one is getting at, hugely discounted distress levels, I think one should look at buying into commercial real estate. Otherwise, as of now, we are still suggesting people to look at residential space, again, at a discounted price.
At a discounted price. Ritesh, REITs, an exciting story. Would you look at also floating a REIT fund, maybe once the permissions are all through? Is that something that a lot of banking and non-banking financial institutions are looking at?
No, certainly. You know, if you look at it, you know, just answering your question, the one that you asked earlier, globally, actually, bulk of the institutional investment in real estate actually goes into property which is stable, income generating, whether it's offices or shopping centers. And that's primarily because what everybody in these markets is chasing is actually a stable yield. And most of the investors in such funds or institutional platforms are actually large pension funds who have pension liabilities to take care of. And what they're really looking for is a stable annuity kind of a yield, which they can generate from investing into high-grade offices or shopping centers. I think in India, what has happened really is that the institutional investment framework, which when it was first conceived in 2005, actually encouraged money to go into development activities, which is why, you know, it was essentially all under construction projects, mostly residential and some commercial, where foreign capital actually flowed in. What we're seeing now is because of the fact that, you know, there's been a general slowdown, commercial absorption has been coming down, or the markets have been softening, there has been last few years a much greater focus on the residential markets. But clearly, you know, having a REIT-like structure for the domestic market is something which is a welcome step. You know, we've been all waiting for it for a long time to come, and we're hopeful now that over the next few months or the next few quarters, once the new government settles down, it would be one of the items that that they would focus on. IDFC or, you know, many of the other financial institutions would certainly look at it as another opportunity or as a new business to focus on.
All right. So now run us through, you know, funds such as yours. How do you go about raising capital, Ritesh? Because these are not investments which are generally open to the larger public. So they basically run through large banks, high net worth clients. And what kind of investor profile do you look at?
So, you know, since the time SEBI came up with the alternative investment fund regulations, essentially the minimum ticket price or the minimum investment per investor in such a fund now has been raised to 1 crore, which essentially puts it clearly as a large HNI product and not really something to be sold at the retail level. So, you know, anybody who's putting in a crore in a fund like this, again, you know, going back to the same math which I did earlier, would probably need to have an investment portfolio at least, you know, I would say 5 to 8 crores, if not more, because this is money which is typically going into a closed-ended fund. It's money which is, you know, likely to be locked in for a period of time, 3 to 4 years, 5 years, depending on the life of the fund. And, you know, obviously these are products which have, you know, a fair amount of risk. So the investor has to be comfortable taking that risk, including the possibility that some part or all of the capital also may get wiped out. So I think it's a very different product compared to what a lot of the retail investors are looking at. And I think rightly so, SEBI has put up a minimum investment amount of 1 crore so that only larger and hopefully more sophisticated investors actually come in.
Okay, fair enough. So that's really for the very, very HNIs. The last question, Vineet and Sameer, which you would probably take on, tier 1 versus tier 2 cities. I mean, again, people have this constant thing, if I go to a smaller town, will I make more money? Very quickly.
No, I think go for the city where you live in. That's what I will advise. Go for your need. Do not stretch yourself. Okay. Do due diligence and proper research and invest carefully. Okay, and be ready to take a loss. There's no guarantee that there's gonna be only gain. I see pain for the real estate market for over the next 2 years. It's a totally buyer's kind of a market where same kind of Me Too products are flooding the market. There is a lot of unsold stock. There is a lot of under construction stock. And I think over the next couple of years, the market is gonna fundamentally change. And as of now, these are, I see some sort of birth pangs happening in the market because the market has fundamentally shifted from a seller's market, it has become a buyer's market.
Sameer, is that true? A lot of what he's saying has been summed up on the show as well, individually.
It's right now a buyer's market, absolutely. But this tier 1 versus tier 2 question, well, the data clearly depicts
that tier 1
will always do better than tier 2 because what is happening is migration.
True.
And that there is still a huge amount of demand supply mismatch on the property side. Right now it is a huge amount of supply, is there a lot, but over a 10-year period or a 5-year period that supply will get absorbed, right? So at this point in time, and there are, India has very few tier 1 cities where there is maximum amount of employment generation that is taking place, especially on the services side or the IT side. So I think clearly tier 1 will do better than tier 2, but some tier 2 cities which will emerge to become like tier 1 cities, like capitals of various states which are tier 2, those could be very good investments as well.
Whole potential. Very quickly, Ramesh, do you have a few points of view?
The finance minister says there are only 45,000 crore patis in the whole of India. So we know where the money is coming from, who are the people who are investing into real estate. So let's be sure that audience wants to be in control. They don't want to allow somebody else to take the decision on his or her behalf. So they would like to go to products which they can take a decision on whether it is buying or exiting by selling.
All right. Harsh Roongta, final sum it up, because for you, you and of course Amrish both play a much larger role. If you were to sum up real estate, how much you've already said, but what are the things that you need to be careful about in the next 2 to 3 years?
So clearly, I think real estate is like any other asset class. If you have a big enough portfolio, it should be part of your portfolio. Just remember, it's a high touch investment. So I completely agree with the gentleman here who says buy it in the city in which you stay. It's a hugely high touch investment, whether you are looking at yield, whether you are looking at exits. So it's very difficult to keep it as a percentage of your portfolio because it is so lumpy. So have it if your portfolio is large enough, realize it is risky, be reasonable in your return expectation. Most importantly, calculate your returns. I mean, because of the law of large numbers, when people see money in crores, they forget that the percentage return may not really be as high. Find out what your real percentage return is, and you may be surprised that it probably isn't as high as you thought it was, and maybe therefore it might be time to exit. So just remember, it's a high touch investment. It's something you should have in your portfolio if your portfolio is big enough, and make sure that you keep track of it. I think it's very easy to become emotionally attached to that asset and not exit at the right time.
In fact, I think while we watch stocks almost on a daily basis, we tend to forget anything about our real estate investments. Anecdotally, we hear it's going up. we do see the value going up. We don't even get down to an Excel sheet to calculate what are the actual returns that that asset has given us, minus all the maintenance costs that we've paid, the renovation fees that we've paid. And I think that's the biggest fallacy here in real estate investment. One, believing that it has a very strong bottom, it won't go down. And secondly, not really looking at the kind of returns you should expect, can expect, and are getting from your real estate asset, and just keeping it in your portfolio because it's there. Gentlemen, thank you very much. It's been a very interesting debate with lovely insights coming from all of you. Amrish Palika, Harsh Rungta, Ritesh Vora, Ramesh, Vineet, and Sameer. Gentlemen, thanks very much. Of course, we don't want you to get fearful and stop investing or buying in real estate. We just want you to make the right choices of what kind and what form and how much of property should be in your portfolio. Well, I'm signing off on behalf of the entire property team. It's a goodbye from me, and join us again on another interesting debate next week.